Uninvisible is a support podcast that deals squarely with medical issues that present unique advocacy issues for individuals. We do not provide medical advice. Please consult with your physician for any medical issue that you are facing. Information and comments that you send to us are governed by our terms of service and privacy policy, which are available on our website located at uninvisiblepod.com. The opinions expressed by guests are their own and are not necessarily the opinion of Uninvisible or the show sponsors. Any advertising that you may hear is accepted without regard to our editorial content. Welcome to Uninvisible. I'm your host, Lauren Friedman, and I'm here with my guests to bring you info, insights, and inspiration for coping with, diagnosing, and treating invisible illness. We're here oversharing so you don't have to struggle with invisibility anymore. All right, guys, thank you so much for joining us. We have a very special guest today to open up the new year, 2020, our one-year anniversary. We have with us Lara Parker. For those of you who don't know, Lara lives with endometriosis. She is also a chronic illness advocate. You might recognize her from Buzzfeed, from Hulu. She had a show with Kelsey Darragh called Can We Cure It? And she also lives with associated pelvic floor conditions to endometriosis. So Lara, thank you so much for joining us. It's such a pleasure to have you on the show.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, and you've got a book coming out this year, so we're going to definitely talk about that as well. But as many of our listeners know, we like to start these interviews by just finding out sort of the basics, and I'd love you to tell us how and when you first realized that something was going on with you.
You know, I've been thinking about this a lot lately as I've been writing my book and just like as I talk more about my illnesses, and like I always used to associate it with when my period started, because my periods were just really, really painful, like from the get-go. But I was actually thinking about it the other day and I realized that I remember having chronic pain of sorts when I was in sixth grade. Like that's when I started noticing like my abdominal bloat, my abdominal swelling, and my abdominal pain.
And before period?
This was before my period. So that's sort of been weird for me to think about, but I don't think I really realized that I had a chronic illness until maybe like 3 years ago. I think I always knew, right? Like they're like, yeah, it doesn't have a cure. But in terms of like really taking that in and learning what it means for my life, I'd say it's been only in the last couple of years that I've really like been like, okay, this is a thing.
That's amazing. Well, especially because people who know you for being very open about what you've been through and trying to find alternative methods to cure your pain and to manage it. So it's really amazing because this really speaks to the idea of being a woman in the medical system and in the world, right? That it often takes time to realize that like actually this isn't normal and that we're not talking about this stuff, which is exactly why you talk about it. So what did you eventually get diagnosed with? What's the whole picture that we're looking at here?
So I've been diagnosed with about 10 to 12 different things at this point, but I was officially diagnosed with endometriosis around 6 years ago. And then after that, which you can only be technically diagnosed with of endometriosis through surgery for anyone who doesn't know. So it's, you know, it's sort of like really invasive and cost prohibitive, but my surgery actually made me feel like 10 times worse and ended up with like all of this unexplained pain. And at that point in my life, I was very sure that this surgery was going to cure me. Like I just thought like, okay, I'm going to go in and I'll come out and I'll feel better and I won't ever think about this again. And like, I look back on that now and I'm like, God, that's sad. Like I wish, you know, but not a reality for chronic illness as anyone listening probably realizes. And after that, I ended up having to go to Mayo Clinic, and I was diagnosed with vaginismus, vulvodynia, overall pelvic floor dysfunction. Since then, we've added PMDD, interstitial cystitis, vulvar vestibulitis, like just so many
different
things.
Can you tell us what some of these things are for people who aren't familiar?
Yeah, so it's just like sort of all variations of pelvic pain. Vaginismus in particular, it's really difficult to have anything enter your vagina, basically. Penetration for me as a straight woman is impossible for a number of different reasons, the most being that it's fucking painful. And I just don't do it. And then vulvodynia is more like the opening of the vagina, and it's like a burning and fiery sensation. It's like more of a nerve situation. Pelvic floor dysfunction is just like when your pelvic floor just isn't working. You can have incontinence. You can always feel like the urge that you have to pee, which like people sort of brush that off as like a side effect, but it's like the most annoying thing if you deal with
it. It's super annoying.
It's horrible. And I hate when doctors are like, yeah, like you just have to feel like you have to pee. And I'm like, it keeps me up at night. Like it is miserable. It's like interstitial cystitis, but it's more commonly referred to now as painful bladder syndrome.
Right.
It's something that is associated with pelvic floor conditions and also just with endometriosis, but it's not something that's really taken seriously in my opinion, or is like recognized often. They're just sort of like, yeah, you have endo. But it's actually like, it's like a cause and effect in my opinion. It's not like proven that having endometriosis means you'll also have pelvic floor dysfunction. Like not every single one that I have by any means, but I mean, they're often associated with one another when there's trauma.
Yeah. So how does this, like, I mean, you've talked about this a lot and you're really open and have helped a lot of other people realize that they have more going on than they think they do. Yes. So how does it change your relationship to your body as a woman and a woman who is openly very, like, you're a sexual person, you're a sexual being, right? Like, how does having pain and discomfort in the place where you're supposed to feel good change your relationship to your body?
Yeah. It's interesting that you say that I'm a sexual person, because for so long, I didn't feel like I was allowed to be. I think like I always like, you know, I've always wanted to have sex. I've always wanted to enjoy it. But because of my conditions, I've never been able to have pain-free penetrative sex like in my entire life. For a really long time, orgasms were really painful. So like to answer your question, I mean, it destroyed my self-esteem. I just felt betrayed by my own body, especially like you said, the area that's supposed to bring you pleasure. So it's just sort of like, I mean, it felt terrible. I just avoided everything sort of altogether because I mean,
it
was terrible. Yeah. I just like felt, I hated my body for what it did to me. And you know, it still does it to me, but I'm trying to get to the place where I realize that my body and I are actually on the same side and we're fighting this trauma and this pain together. It just doesn't always feel that way.
And there are a lot of new like coping techniques and devices out there, like things like the Onut and different like dilating devices that you've talked about a lot. Are they helping using these tools?
Yeah. So that's another thing that I've had to sort of like reframe is like, I used to think that like, if I didn't get to a place where I could have pain-free penetrative sex or even have it at all, let alone be it pain-free, it's just like, that was my end goal. And now it's sort of like, oh my God, the fact that I can orgasm, the fact that I can talk to you about orgasming without bursting into tears, wanting to leave the room and talk about how much of a failure I am or how unlovable I am. I mean, I've just sort of like changed my goal, I guess, if that makes sense.
Yeah, but which takes a lot of work, because it's not just the physical stuff that you're dealing with and like prep work just to have sexual encounters, but it's also a mental battle, isn't it?
Absolutely. I mean, it's like going to the doctor if you have a chronic illness. I mean, you're anxious. You're like, I can't do this. Like, this is going to be terrible. I only associated very, very painful experiences with any sort of sexual encounter. So for me going into it, of course I was like, I had to like fully talk to myself and like talk myself down and be like, it's not going to hurt. I mean, I still do that though. Like I still have that problem.
Well, cause it's so hard to separate that when you've spent your whole life sort of anticipating pain and managing pain. In, you know, again, this area that's supposed to be a center of joy and pleasure, right? And to be able to like separate the two is, I don't know how you get to that point where you can actually make that separation, because it's a part of your existence at this point, right? Like,
no, absolutely. I think like my MO is always to just reframe things. I guess that's like what therapy is really. And that's like what I've learned the most is just like, it sucks, but like, how do I reframe it?
Thank you so much for tuning in. For the full episode, click the link below. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button to access future episodes. Turn on those notifications. Share this video if you enjoyed it, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Uninvisible Pod.